Hello and welcome. My name is Gabriel Dominguez, and I'm the Asia-Pacific editor at Jane's Defense Weekly. It is my great pleasure to welcome you to this online intelligence briefing. Today, the 2nd of August, I, together with Rukmani Gupta, military capabilities analyst for the Asia-Pacific, Craig Caffrey, principal analyst for defense budgets, and John Gravatt, defense industry analyst for the Asia-Pacific, will present a session entitled Power and Politics in the South China Sea. The Jane's Intelligence Briefing Program will consist of approximately 40 events during 2017 and is available to all customers of Jane's Intelligence Center and Module products, including the Markets Forecast product. I would like to highlight that the information used to compile today's presentation has been drawn from a variety of Jane's content, but particularly from Jane's military and security assessments.
In this section of the briefing, I will review the most recent developments that have a bearing on the South China Sea disputes and then discuss the naval capabilities of key claimants. 1 year since the PCA ruling that China does not enjoy historic rights to areas within its 9-dash claim line, little seems to have changed on the ground. However, China has made efforts to engage with regional states diplomatically, and one consequence of this has been the agreement on a draft code of conduct for the South China Sea. This COC is set to be consolidated during the ASEAN foreign ministers meeting underway in Manila. Earlier this year, the United States Navy resumed freedom of navigation operations in the South China Sea after a gap of about 7 months. Under the Trump administration, the USN has undertaken 2 FONOPs, one each in the Spratlys and the Paracels. Both of these saw USN vessels sail within 12 nautical miles of the features controlled by China. In my view, the FONOPs should be viewed within the broader context of a long-standing bilateral issue between the United States and China on what the freedom of navigation encompasses. It remains unclear just what these FONOPs mean for other claimants. They represent perhaps an effective challenge to Chinese expansionism in terms of non-recognition by major powers, but very little other than that, especially since these other claimants are unlikely to emulate the United States Navy and their own area of operations will remain limited. Coming to naval capabilities, we see that modernization efforts are continuing across the region, and these efforts can be viewed as a response to increasingly frequent so-called routine patrolling by Chinese vessels in disputed waters. While majority of the claimants are expanding existing structures, China and Vietnam have also undertaken the creation of terrain where they did not earlier maintain a military outpost. But even as China is expanding its naval area of operations in the region, efforts by other countries are primarily focused on mitigating the possibility of reduced access as a consequence of intensified Chinese presence.
We're going to take a look at air power now, which is a crucial but sometimes neglected element of the South China Sea strategic environment, and one that we're expecting to become far more prominent as China starts to back its growing naval presence in the region with air power. Really, the most high-profile indication of this growing importance has really been the construction or enhancement of air bases in the region by China, Indonesia, the Philippines, Taiwan, and Vietnam. China's new bases, in particular in the Spratlys, now mean that they have runways or air bases effectively 700 miles south of the Chinese mainland. So clear signs from all sides, really, that air power is expected to become a more important aspect of the conflict going forward. And this is really because the vast expanses of the South China Sea really mean that air power is arguably the key means by which to maintain effective situational awareness in the region. But as time progresses, the issue of air power will likely rest really on two key factors: the extent to which China can project its assets southward, and efforts by other states in the region to counter those efforts. So what about actual capabilities? This chart compares the number of fighter aircraft in service for the various littoral states. And in terms of sheer quantity, obviously China's supremacy is very clear there. Operates around 3 times as many fighters as all of the other states combined, or still twice as many even if you just count modern aircraft as well. And while much of this inventory is limited to providing territorial defense, and it can't really be projected into the South China Sea, the pace of the modernization of China's inventory is another key aspect here. The introduction of new aircraft, like the J-20 fifth generation aircraft seen at the bottom of the page there, is serving to kind of remove the technological edge that Taiwan in particular has previously enjoyed over China. But modernization of fighter inventories is really continuing throughout the region. Defense spending by the South China Sea littoral states has doubled in the last decade, hit $226 billion this year, as you can see in the chart there. That equates to growth of more than 7% a year in a period where, in global terms, if you look at global terms, defense spending has actually been under immense pressure.
In this section, I'll show you how China is expanding its defense trade and technology ties with Southeast Asia and what impact that is having on regional relationships. In the first slide here, we have a map showing the extent of China's presence in Southeast Asia as a defense exporter. And all China's customers here are in green. As you can see, China has sold military equipment to just about every country in the region apart from Singapore and Brunei. China is not the region's biggest military supplier, but its sales to Southeast Asia are on the rise, especially since 2010, as you can see from the other graph on this slide. This increase coincides with when China really started to realize its potential as an exporter to support its strategic goals. And of course, this emphasis has been boosted enormously by President Xi Jinping, who came to power in 2014. Now, on this slide, we have a breakdown of China's defense sales in the region with statistics sourced from Jane's Balance of Trade. And there are a few interesting things here. Firstly, Thailand's purchases have expanded rapidly since its military coup in 2014, which has weakened its partnership with the U.S. Myanmar has long been a Chinese defense customer, but Indonesia only recently in the last decade. China's engagement in Southeast Asia has expanded rapidly in the last decade and now includes all elements of defense industrial collaboration, including technology transfers, assisting in local production and support, the development of infrastructure, and even facilitating exports. And these activities are tailored to meet customers' requirements. So, for example, the provision of technologies to provide basic MRO is important for Cambodia, while Thailand is looking to develop a local defense industrial base, while Indonesia wants to export. What's interesting, too, is that local industry in the region has had quite a free hand in utilizing the Chinese technologies and adapting them for their own purposes.
I would like to talk about the potential future scenarios in the South China Sea dispute, and focus mainly on the actions likely to be taken by two major military powers in the region, China and the United States. I will also speak briefly about the Vietnamese position. The U.S. has stressed the need for diplomatic efforts to resolve the South China Sea disputes, meaning that Washington does not see military action as the first choice. Instead, the U.S. is likely to try to rally diplomatic support, in my view, from Southeast Asian nations and build a broader coalition to counter China's ambitions in the area. Nonetheless, as the major military power in the region, the U.S. is also keen to defend its strategic interests in the area and to demonstrate its resolve to continue to fly, sail, and operate wherever international law allows. China is likely to continue to reiterate its opposition to U.S. involvement in the area, arguing that it wants to resolve the disputes through negotiations with the parties directly concerned. To this end, China is likely to continue enhancing bilateral diplomatic, economic, and defense ties with the countries in the region and prevent any escalation of tensions that could give the U.S. a justification to step up its military presence in the region. Another interesting development is that British Foreign Minister Boris Johnson recently raised the possibility of the U.K. sending aircraft carriers to the region to show its commitment to freedom of navigation. We have also seen reports of Australia hinting that it would support or play a role alongside Britain in asserting freedom of navigation in that part of the world. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm afraid that's all we have time for. This concludes the seminar. Thank you for joining us for this event. We look forward to welcoming you to future online briefings. Our next online briefing, which is on Argentina's defense sector, will be held on the 17th of August. Thank you and goodbye.